sisters say your social grace is bow your head. They're pious here, but you and I, we're pioneers. We make our own rules, our own room, no bias here. Let 'em say.
You've taken your first step into a larger world.
You ready for this?
We'll all be together at long last. Connected.
That's just to hear the audio.
Test, test. Hi, everyone. Test, test. Or, wait.
Oh, I recorded. I started recording. That's why I pointed at you.
A few moments later.
Still recording.
Hey everyone, Robyn here. Welcome to my dining room. I really miss seeing everyone's faces every week, and let's be honest, you probably miss the Tirados too. I give some good hugs, Sway gives some good roasts, and my children provide endless laughs on Wednesday nights for you all as we try to wrangle them up for dinner. I can't wait to be together again. This will end, but in the meantime, please stay safe, stay home. Take care of your families. I love you guys. Okay, so today I wanted to share with you about three things that Jesus demonstrated for us when he was here on earth. Service, grace, and forgiveness. One of the things I love about God is that he knew we needed to see with our own human eyes how Jesus wanted us to live. How we should interact with one another, how we should serve one another, how we should love people, how we should treat other people. Reading about it or hearing about it wouldn't be enough. He knew that. And so he sends Jesus to do that and so much more. Obviously, Jesus was sent to die for our sins so that we could have eternal life. But I also believe that Jesus was sent to show us an example of how God wants us to live every day. So we're going to be reading in John today. If you have your Bibles, pick it up. But before we do that, I have a very important question to ask you. Do you like the movie Mulan? I hope you said yes, because I love this movie. And normally, I am not a fan of Disney princess movies because, listen, girls, you don't need a man to save you. Jesus saved you 2,000 years ago. I know, that's so cheesy, but it's true. But that's not what I'm here to talk about today. So let's talk about Mulan. She's not your average Disney princess. She is smart, she is brave, she is tough, she's a kick butt warrior. She demonstrates this amazing sacrificial love for her father, for her family, for her country. But I have something to confess about this movie. I actually had never seen it until this week. And it's from like 1998, which is the year I graduated high school. I know that dates me, but the movie is old and I had never seen it till just this week, but I loved it. So I thought maybe there was other people that didn't, had never seen the movie, and I wanted to give you a quick recap. Okay, so Mulan is a teenage girl living with her family in China. The emperor gets word that they're gonna be invaded by the Huns, so he mandates that every family sends one man to basically join the Chinese army to then defend their country. Unfortunately, the only man in Mulan's family is her dad, who's old and sick, and is a war veteran, so he's been through many wars, and she doesn't want to see him get sent off to war again because she knows he won't make it back this time. So she decides to pretend that she'll be a man and she'll go fight for him. So she takes her father's old armor, she cuts her hair, and voila, she's ready to enlist. At training camp, her disguise seems to be working pretty well, and she calls herself Ping so that she can fit in with the other warriors. And at one point in the movie, fast forward a little bit, the army is ambushed by the Huns, and it looks like they're all about to die. Ping cleverly uses one of the cannons. She shoots it up to the big mountain and causes this giant avalanche, and it traps all of the Huns. Their commander is obviously very outraged and manages to wound her. They get her to the little hospital thing and they bandage her up, but during this process, her true identity is revealed. By law, her captain is supposed to execute her for her deception, but because of her bravery in saving everybody in the avalanche, he spares her life. He does, however, expel her from the army, and she's left to follow alone while the rest of the army goes to the Imperial City to report the news of the Huns' destruction. It is then discovered that some of the Hun warriors, including their commander, had survived the avalanche, and Mulan catches sight of them as she's following the army to the palace. Once they get there, she convinces everyone that the Hun leader is still alive, and she sneaks her way back into the palace, tracks him down, finds him, and they battle it out like on this big rooftop scene. She basically launches a giant rocket at him and shoots him into this fireworks tower, and boom, he's gone. Initially, Mulan is reprimanded for her destroying of the palace and shaming her family, but then everyone is praising her and honoring her for her bravery in defeating the Huns when no one else could do it. Okay, so you might be wondering, why am I talking so much about a Disney movie when I told you I was going to talk about service, grace, and forgiveness? But I want you to think about it. Mulan gave the ultimate sacrifice when she disguised herself so she could fight instead of her father. She was willing to die in his place. Sounds a little familiar to someone else that we know that died for us. Mulan should have been executed for what she did, but her captain showed her grace and forgiveness by allowing her to live. And even after she followed them to the palace and defeated the Hun leader, she was praised, not reprimanded, for her actions. And as Christians, we must be willing to sacrifice for others just as Mulan did. And in exchange, God will show us the same grace and forgiveness that she was given. I never thought that watching a Disney movie would make me think so much about God, but you know what? God will use anything to talk to us. That's another thing I love about him. We don't just have to read our Bible or go to church or watch a YouTube sermon. God wants to talk to us in normal everyday life. He's cool like that. Okay, so we are going to pick up our Bibles and we're going to learn a little more about Jesus in John 13. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own, who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. I can never say that. Iscariot. It's okay if you can't pronounce all the words in the Bible. You should keep reading. To betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God, and he was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I'm doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. I am not referring to all of you. I know those I have chosen, but this is to fulfill the passage of Scripture. He who shared my bread has turned against me. I am telling you now before it happens, so that when it does, when it does happen, you will believe that I am who I am. Very truly I tell you, whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me." So something we have to keep in mind about this situation. In this time period, it was very demeaning to wash someone else's feet. It was basically the house person's job, or the servant. So when people would come over for dinner, you would have your slave or your servant greet the people and wash their feet, and then they could come in and hang out with the rest of the people. And so for Jesus to do this, it really showed his servant attitude. He wanted to humble himself and to show that he wanted to serve people. He even tells his disciple, as clear as day, "I have set an example." He's telling us, he's commanding us what to do. It doesn't get any more clear than that. He wants us to wash other people's feet. He wants us to serve with love. He wants us to sacrifice what we might not want to do for what other people need us to do. I'm going to say that again because that really hit me home after I wrote it down. We should be sacrificing what we might not want to do for what other people need us to do. Do you have trouble sacrificing for others? I certainly do. But I would suggest this. What empowers our sacrifice for others is Jesus' sacrifice for us. He gave everything for you, for me. And if it's not below Jesus, it shouldn't be below us. Jesus only expects his disciples to wash someone else's feet after they have been washed themselves. And so how do we do this? It's not like you just turn on the light switch and boom, you're ready to wash people's feet and serve 24/7. There's one word, grace. And grace empowers works. Works don't empower grace. And I think that's where we get it mixed up sometimes. We are covered in God's grace, and that should empower us to do good works in this world. We should not be doing good to earn God's grace. It doesn't work that way. It's impossible. And when we get these things mixed up, it leads to burnout and frustration. And if you feel burnt out or frustrated, maybe that's why. Maybe you're thinking about this wrong. So take some time to reflect on Jesus's work. The ultimate sacrifice. What he did for us is enough. And once you really get that, it provides rest and comfort like you've never felt before. So while I don't think Jesus is calling us to actually wash people's feet right now, let's be honest, we're social distancing, we're not allowed to be around people, but I do think he's calling us to serve and sacrifice in different ways. Maybe you need to take some time to serve your family at home. I'm willing to bet your parents could use some help right now. Laundry never ends, you guys, like ever, and the dishes don't stop. Serve a younger sibling who needs help with their schoolwork. You're all trying to do school from home right now, and I know it's hard. Or maybe it's help with yard work. Cut the grass. Pour some mulch. The opportunity to serve at home is literally a daily one, and I encourage you to take it. And while serving one another is a very tangible thing, grace and forgiveness is a little bit trickier. But oh man, do we need that right now. Anyone feeling cramped in your house, maybe tired of your family, frustrated with how your parents or your teachers are handling this situation? How about showing them some grace as we're all just trying to figure this out right now? Forgive them when maybe they snap at you because the stress is getting to be too much. Show some grace when you're asked to do something that you hadn't been asked to do before. My hope and prayer is through this weird time that we leave better people than when we started. I pray that our families are stronger than ever, and that our relationships with God are reinvigorated and we learn to trust him more. So I'm gonna pray for you guys tonight. God, I just thank you so much for these students that are listening to this message, that they would really understand how much you love us and how much you have for us, especially as we're walking through these uncertain times of quarantine and social distancing and doing school at home. Lord, I ask that you would speak to them and that they would hear you and they would understand exactly what you have for them. That help these kids to really get the service aspect of what Jesus was preaching on, Lord. And not just preaching on how he was doing it. He was willing to get dirty in people's feet water, which is so gross. Lord, help us to be more like Jesus. Help us to see what he did and help that to empower us to do more for those around us. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I miss you guys.
My eyes above what it looks like, I will only see all you promised me.